As I said, that it's a controversial topic because many refractive surgeons believe in it, many don't. Topography guided treatment for irregular cornea. So basically, the basic idea is that it is a customized excimer laser guided treatment based on topographic map. And it was introduced quite long back, but has been popular among some of the surgeons and not in many. And the basic idea is to regularize the irregular cornea. And maps are obtained, it's transferred to the machine, and then a laser ablation profile is created. Yeah. And then it is designed to improve the central corneal symmetry. And it basically helps in treating the irregular cornea because it's based on corneal maps, and that is how it improves. So the important indications can be keratoconus, post-keratoplasty, and post-laser vision correction, wherein you can have irregular cornea. As I said, TCAT can help, you know, regularize the corneal surface, but when you do an ablation, the keratoconus, in keratoconic cornea, there can be a thinning of cornea. So you have to stabilize it because there is destabilization of corneal structure. So topo-guided PRK should be combined with CXL in cases of keratoconus. And then the patient has to be counseled also that additional procedures like contact lens implantation or intracorneal ring segment or phakic implants can be required for visual rehabilitation in these patients. So basically, corneal cross-linking for stiffening and disease stabilization in irregular cornea and topo-guided ablation as step one of visual rehabilitation followed by step two. So the indications can be cases of mild and moderate keratoconus, progressive or non-progressive, any unacceptable visual acuity with glasses, because if the patient is happy with glasses, then he will not undergo any procedure. So you can, if the patient is unhappy, then of course you can regularize the cornea and then give glasses or contact lens, the patient will be happy. And the treatment goal, as I said, is to improve the post-operative best corrected visual acuity and not uncorrected visual acuity. And so it's suitable in patients with preoperative corneal thickness of more than 450 microns, with estimated postoperative corneal thickness of 400 microns, well-centered cone and best corrected visual acuity less than 6/12. And it should be avoided in cases wherein there is an active allergic eye disease or ocular inflammation or any scar which is involving the central cornea or patient is having excessive, advanced keratoconus. So the treatment protocol is based on the Athens protocol, which was proposed in 2011. I won't go into details of it. You do a PTK 50 microns, then do a topo-guided PRK 50 microns, and then do a cross-linking, and then it gives a good outcome. Then an enhanced Athens protocol was proposed in 2019, wherein maximum stromal ablation in the Athens protocol was 50 microns. Here it was 30 microns ablated over the thinnest cone, and then 50 microns epithelial PTK done. And then accelerated cross-linking or customized cross-linking is done, and it has been found to be quite effective. There is less tissue removal, that is 30 microns instead of 50 microns. Now the question is whether we should do it together or sequential. Some people have recommended together, some people have recommended sequential. Now together, if you do simultaneous, it has its own advantages. It's a single procedure. You are getting a better laser ablation predictability as you are ablating a virgin cornea. Better riboflavin penetration as Bowman's membrane ablated, but then the cross-linking also modulates the surface, and so you don't know because you're combining PRK along with cross-linking. However, there are studies which have shown that simultaneous procedure has been found to be better, but there are many studies which have shown that sequential is better. This is a meta-analysis, which is meta-analysis of all the studies, and they found out the sequential protocol revealed better outcome. First, you do a cross-linking, and later on, you do a PRK topo-guided to remove whatever is the abnormality. So I'll just move on fast. What is important in preoperative concern is epithelial mapping on ASOCT. You should rule out epithelial conditions, other conditions which cause epithelial irregularity. And then you do an ablation of about 50 microns. As I have already mentioned about the Athens protocol, so I'll just skip this also. PTK has been found to be showing better results. However, there are people who have shown better results with manual removal of epithelium as well. Now, Kimionis group have favored the trans-PTK, and that's what they proposed, the Creighton protocol, wherein trans-PTK was done followed by soaking of enlargement of the epithelial debridement by you know, a further 2 millimeters, and then stroma soaked with riboflavin and UVA rays introduced, and conventional cross-linking done with a good result. Most of the people use intraoperative mitomycin C, 0.02% for 20 to 40 seconds. And in post-LVC cases wherein decentered ablation, flap-related complications, etc., also turbo-guided ablation has been found to be quite effective. I guess it's one of the good indications wherein we can do it. Post-PK and post-DALP patients also, turbo-guided ablation has been done. However, again, there are limited cases wherein it will have a very good effect. This is one study which has shown good effect after PKP and DALK, wherein topo-guided ablation was done. So in conclusion, topo-guided PRK is maybe a useful tool to correct or reduce the corneal topographic irregularity. But in cases of keratoconus, that is the real definition of irregular cornea, it should be combined with cross-linking. And patients should be counseled that additional procedures like contact lens fitting or intracorneal ring segment or maybe phakic implant may be required in order to provide the ultimate visual rehabilitation. Thank you very much for your patience.